Pat Labor is a name that undoubtedly many Western fans of anime have heard tossed around online, at conventions, or in their group of friends. Despite this, many Western fans aren't familiar with the franchise or haven't been directly exposed to it. So what exactly is Pat Labor? Well, in short, it's a hard science fiction mecha series created in the late 1980s by a small group of Japan's most influential artists, creators, and writers. But of course, it's much more than that. So today we'll be delving into the history and legacy of Pat Labor, a forgotten franchise. Before we even get into Pat Labor, we need to delve a bit into its creators, Headgear. Headgear is a five-member artistic collective that was created in the late 1980s in order to ensure that the members would own the rights to their own works, which is atypical in the anime industry. Usually the rights are split between members of a production committee or owned by an animation studio. It's important to note that Pat Labor was the only anime and media franchise this group would ever release under the Headgear name. The members would, of course, work on many projects together after Pat Labor waned from the spotlight, but nothing else would receive the official Headgear stamp. Headgear's members consisted of director Mamoru Oshii, mangaka Masami Yuki, screenwriter Kazunori Ito, mecha designer Yutaka Izubuchi, and character designer Akemi Takada. Other well-known names often associated with Headgear and the Pat Labor franchise are composer Kenji Kawai and Ghost in the Shell standalone complex director Kenji Kamiyama. So what exactly does the universe of Pat Labor look like? Taking place in what was the near future of 1998 to 2002, Pat Labor follows the Tokyo Metropolitan Police Special Vehicle Section 2, Division 2. This elite squad of police officers, pilots, engineers, and mechanics operate in a world dominated by the use of labors, large robots used in heavy construction work. At their disposal is a fleet of patrol labors, or Pat Labors for short, that the main character Noa Izumi, a labor pilot, and her cohorts use to combat labor-based crime on the streets of Tokyo and beyond. So, now that we know just a little bit about the creators and have a frame of mind for the franchise's universe, it's time to dig into the history of Pat Labor, also known by its full name, Mobile Police Pat Labor. This is actually pretty hard to do chronologically, not only because Pat Labor has spanned many iterations and types of media, but also because the entire franchise is split down the middle between two separate universes. One based on the TV series, often called the TV universe, and one based on the films, often called the film universe. We'll be tackling the TV universe first, and if I'm honest, that's because I want to save the best for last. Officially called Pat Labor on Television, the Pat Labor TV series began running on October 11, 1989 and ran for 47 episodes, eventually ending its run in 1990. It was directed by Naoyuki Yoshinaga, who before that had directed several episodes of Urusei Yatsura and staffed by all the usual suspects of Headgear in their respective design and writing roles. Animation production was handled by Sunrise, and one of the most important things to know about Pat Labor as an anime franchise is, since the rights are owned by the members of Headgear exclusively, animation production for all the different series and projects was not beholden to one studio. This means that while the TV series was animated by Sunrise, several other studios were involved in making the other anime projects, which we'll get into a bit later. Following the TV series was a 16-episode original video animation series that was released between 1990 and 1992. These OVAs finish the last arc of the TV series and also include several new standalone episodes. The TV series and following OVAs take a lot of cues from the original manga, both in the sense that the design aesthetics are very similar, but also because the TV series sought to either replicate or adapt several of the manga's story arcs. It also introduced several new characters to the anime side of Pat Labor that, up until that point, had only ever been seen in the manga. Overall, I think the TV universe is a competent and fun take on Pat Labor, but ultimately it's strange and generally inferior when compared to the film universe. Many of the episodes are entirely standalone and often stray into territory that cheapens what makes Pat Labor great, including battling giant monsters, looking for lost cats, parodying other genres of science fiction, and other slapstick comedy scenarios that don't really serve up much substance for the viewer. In 1988, the first Pat Labor anime outing began its release, a 7-part OVA series originally called Pat Labor The Mobile Police, but later rebranded to the more recognizable Pat Labor The Early Days, so as not to confuse it with the later 1990 OVA series. This would mark the beginning of what is considered the film universe, the other universe within the Pat Labor franchise, and in my opinion, the superior, more drama and intrigue-driven offering. Originally, 6 episodes were to be produced, directed by Mamoru Oshii, with a special 7th episode directed by TV series director Yoshinaga, which was developed after the fact to promote the first Pat Labor movie that came out afterwards. Headgear's main staff again filled their respective roles, with frequent Oshii collaborator Kenji Kawai providing the soundtrack, and animation this time being handled by Studio Deen. Despite the dramatic overtones presiding over the film universe, this initial OVA series is known for striking a more comedic and lighthearted tone at times, much like the TV series. Hell, they even managed to fit in another episode about battling a giant sea monster. On July 15, 1989, the first Pat Labor theatrical film was released in Japanese theaters, continuing directly on story-wise from the end of the original OVA series. Again directed by Mamoru Oshii, animation was this time handled by IG Tatsunoko, the studio that would later become Production IG. They would also animate Pat Labor's second film as well. Many people watching this video will have undoubtedly heard of director Mamoru Oshii from his directing the 1995 film adaptation of Ghost in the Shell, and it was in this first Pat Labor film that he began to develop the signature directorial style used in his later works, especially the Ghost in the Shell films. Many signature Oshii directorial quirks were used for the first time, including numerous fisheye lens shots, long dialogue-free wide-shot montage sequences set to music, and heavy use of animal and religious imagery. This also marks the first time that Pat Labor was released to English-speaking audiences with an English dub produced by Manga Entertainment. Unfortunately, the dub is less than stellar, with several voice lines being altered in the dub that completely change certain scenes. I'll get to where you can watch it legally later, but take it from me now, don't watch it in English. Following the success of the first film, a second theatrical release called Pat Labor 2 The Movie was released on August 7, 1993. This was a bit of an experiment for Oshii and friends, as it is kind of a standalone film adapting, reworking, and expanding on episodes 5 and 6 from the OVA series. Oshii's directorial style continues to shine here, so much so that he was reportedly offered the Ghost in the Shell director's job solely for his work on Pat Labor 2. The film is unique in many respects, not only for its intrigue and politics-heavy subject matter, but also for its continuing bird motifs, heavily concentrated color palette, and mecha designs contributed by Macross creator Shoji Kawamori. The release of Pat Labor 2 would mark the end of Pat Labor in anime for 9 years, until the release of the third Pat Labor movie, Wasted 13. Billed as Pat Labor 3 The Movie, Wasted 13 is actually a side story taking place between the first and second Pat Labor films, set in the year 2000, which is actually 2 years before the film itself was released. It follows two detectives as they try to track down the culprit of several brutal attacks on labors, assisted by the main characters from the original series. This time animated by Studio Madhouse, it was directed by SDF Macross episode director Fumihiko Takayama, with an original story by frequent Headgear collaborator Torimiki. Character design was also brought in from outside Headgear, with New Dominion Tank Police's character designer Hiroki Takagi filling in. Reception for this one was lukewarm, with many people citing weak source material and the lack of Headgear powerhouses such as Oshii as the reason behind its lackluster performance. Particularly of note is a series of 3 shorts aired before Wasted 13 in theaters called Mini Pato, which were presented in a super deformed chibi style and aimed to explain the conceit behind the Pat Labor universe to new viewers. They were a mix between 2D paper cutouts, traditional animation, and live action, and were all directed by Kenji Kamiyama, who would then go on to direct Ghost in the Shell Standalone Complex. The PatLabor franchise doesn't stop at anime, though. A few live-action attempts have been made, starting with a test film directed by Oshii himself in 1998. With a meager 2-minute runtime simply designed to show off Oshii's skills as a live-action director, nothing ever came of it, but it's an interesting watch and is currently available in potato quality on YouTube. In 2014, a live-action follow-up series, also directed by Oshii, set in the film universe 11 years after PatLabor 2 and called PatLabor: The Next Generation, began airing. It finished airing in 2015 and was soon followed by a theatrical film called Tokyo War, ending the arc originally begun in the TV series. Both the series and the ensuing film were considered critical and financial failures, with fans of the anime disappointed in the lack of creativity exhibited by the series, as well as home video sales for the series being mediocre at best, and the film being the biggest financial flop of its year. PatLabor has also had several forays into print media. The original manga, which I spoke about briefly earlier, was written and illustrated by Masami Yuki, principal mangaka of Headgear, and the original creator behind the PatLabor concept. It began serialization in Shonen Sunday Weekly magazine in 1998, almost exactly at the same time as the first episode of the early days OVA series was released, and ran until 1994. Several light novels have also been published since PatLabor's creation, with the first series running from 1989 to 1994, and written by Michiko Yokote, a screenwriter for the TV series. A prequel series of light novels was released in 2011 before the Next Generation live-action series was released, written by Mamoru Oshii himself, and another series based on the live-action spin-off began in 2014, written by screenwriter Kei Yamamura. So whatever happened to PatLabor? And what made it so good in the first place? Well, part of the reason why I think PatLabor faded from the spotlight even with its rabid Japanese fanbase was the changing nature of the anime industry during the height of its popularity. As the 80s waned and the 90s came of age, popular anime in many ways began to move away from hard science fiction and character-driven drama. In addition, many of the creators behind the drive making PatLabor initially popular began to move on to work on other projects, most notably of which was Mamoru Oshii. PatLabor arguably would never have become as popular as it was in the first place without his guidance, and after directing PatLabor 2 and working on Ghost in the Shell, Oshii would for a time forsake anime altogether and instead focus on live-action pursuits, a, in my opinion, misguided force that still drives him to this day. For those of you wondering why you should even watch PatLabor in the first place, for me it really comes down to the fact that it truly is some of the best storytelling and world-building the late 80s and early 90s had to offer. The characters are all individually compelling, with their own distinct motivations that quickly endear themselves to the viewer, backed up by incredibly focused mechanical design and a vision of the near future that is dire, but more optimistic than other forward-looking anime of the day. It definitely carries the same DNA as Ghost in the Shell and Akira, but tends to be a bit more lighthearted in how it tackles the solutions to these future problems. Now, after everything we've talked about so far, an important question remains. Where the heck can you even watch PatLabor nowadays anyway? Well, for US fans, there's good news and bad news. First, the good news. The three theatrical anime films, the original OVA series, the TV series, and accompanying New Files OVA series, are all licensed by Made in Japan in the States and are available on home video right now. That covers just about all the PatLabor anime one could watch, but unfortunately the bad news is, that's basically where legal PatLabor in the US starts and stops. The original manga is out of print in the States and has been since the late 90s, the light novels have never been published here, and no fan translations exist to any extensive degree. In addition, the live-action TV series and ensuing movie have never been licensed in the States and probably never will be. So, take my advice. If you have no experience with PatLabor and are wondering where to start, your best bet is with the film universe. Watch the early days OVA series followed by the two movies. If after watching those your interest is piqued, check out the Wasted 13 film and the TV series and accompanying OVA series. If after that your thirst for more PatLabor still exists, then congratulations, you're on your way to becoming a super fan and certainly don't need my help to find more stuff to consume. Finally, we have to talk about the future of the Pat Labor franchise, which as of late seems pretty exciting. In October of 2016, Studio Kara, the animation studio behind the Evangelion Rebuild films, released the Mobile Police Pat Labor reboot, an 8-minute original net animation as part of their Japan Animator Expo series of short films. It was directed by Patema Inverted director Yasuhiro Yoshiura, with character design from Osamatsu-san's Naoyuki Asano, a screenplay co-written by Headgear's own Kazunori Ito, and fantastic music by the one and only Kenji Kawai that sounds ripped straight out of the 80s. In addition, the character voices in the short are provided by veteran voice actors Megumi Hayashibara and Koichi Yamadera. So far, it's only been released on home video in Japan, but the Japanese release comes with English subtitles and Japanese Blu-rays work with players in the US, so if you really want to see it, that's certainly a viable option. In addition to the reboot, a new project called Pat Labor EZY was announced in 2017 by Genko president Taro Maki. We don't know a whole lot about the project other than the fact that it exists, including a release date or which animation studio will be animating it. But it was recently confirmed that Kazunori Ito would again be involved. Either way, with a new Pat Labor project in the works, it seems as though we might be on the cusp of a resurgence of the franchise, with an entirely new generation of anime fans discovering it for the first time. That's a future for an underappreciated franchise that, to me, looks pretty bright. Thanks so much for watching, everyone. I'd highly encourage all of you to visit this website, patlabor.info, to find out much more than I can fit into this video regarding Pat Labor. It's one of the best anime fan sites out there, and it helped me so much in the creation of this video, so please head over and give that site your time. Also, feel free to subscribe if you like this video and want more like it. Until next time.